As you will see in all studies, you will not find anywhere neuro-ophthalmic causes of blindness mentioned, and it is one of the least glamorous specialties of ophthalmology. My job here is to tell you as to what I have found when I'm practicing neuro-ophthalmology in a tertiary care institution. The challenges in neuro-ophthalmology is about the diagnosis part of the clinic running. How do you manage your patient? And of course, as we have been talking about it in this hall for the last few hours, as to what are the job prospects and how do you manage yourself when you are going for the earning. My friends talk about neuro-ophthalmology in this way. I would like you to pause and...
Aur is tarah, na to koi sachai ke liye ladne wala rahega, na hi insaaf mangne wala. Reh jayegi to sirf tareek. Aur yahi hota raha hai, Milad. तारीख पर तारीख, तारीख पर तारीख, तारीख पर तारीख, तारीख पर तारीख मिलती रही है, लेकिन इंसाफ नहीं मिला मिलोड, इंसाफ नहीं मिला, मिली है तो सिर्फ ये तारीख।
Yeah, so this is what the general perception is, that what we do in neuro-ophthalmology is patient comes in, gives steroids, and patient anyway does not recover vision, and that's why it is not very gratifying. Well, let me give you an example of this kid who came to us, was diagnosed as having amblyopia, was running around for 6 to 8 months, came to us, and our group saw that there was a subtle nystagmus in her left eye, if you can see it here. And with the training, we knew that unilateral nystagmus is generally neurological in origin, unless proved otherwise. We did the neuroimaging. Patient was found to have a tumor in her brain, which was removed promptly, and there was a gratification of saving her vision and saving her life. So there is other side. I mean, yes, there are lots of instances where we give steroids and patient does not recover vision, but there are patients like this which can be very satisfying or gratifying. The other problem with neuro-ophthalmology is that you have so many conditions and you have so many investigations that you do to arrive at a diagnosis, so there is no clinical skill involved. That's one of the cons which is mentioned a lot of times, and partly that's right. You end up with a scenario where you don't know whether the person's optic neuropathy is one of these, but then that's a challenge. It allows you to play a detective and try to find out as to what's happening with the patient. And in many instances, patients do recover vision, and in many instances you are able to, as we saw, you are able to uncover life-threatening problems. Another problem or another blame on neuro-ophthalmology is that ultimately, whichever way you do it, you are still referring all your patients. Your job is that of a traffic police. You do it this way or you do it that way, you still refer your patients. So what is your role? What do you do? Well, here is my case. This is a case which was referred to us by a neurologist saying that you cannot find out why that patient is suffering from headache for the last 4 months. And when he came to us, we saw that the pupil in the right side was normal. And then we were examining the patient in the left eye. Pupil was mid-dilated. We were seeing the pupil on the slit lamp. And we discovered that there was some vermiform movement, which probably you'll be able to find. And this vermiform movement of the pupil in the left eye was exaggerated when patient adducted that particular eye, meaning thereby that there was something wrong with this. There can be a mid-dilated pupil, vermiform movement generally seen in AD's pupil, but does not show this exaggeration of vermiform movement when patient adducts the eye. And so we realize that this probably is an aberrant regeneration of the third nerve. People who have pale disc edema, diplopia, nystagmus, who can be treated or at least can be diagnosed, or a general ophthalmologist or a cataract surgeon would be very happy to palm off a pale. We have trained two neuro-ophthalmologists so far who are not doing any other work but neuro-ophthalmology in a private practice in Gujarat, and both of them are doing well. So salary prospects or starting your practice, and remember, you don't need much of investment when you start your neuro-ophthalmology practice. You need a good torch so that you can look for RAPD, need a Ishihara color chart for color vision and maybe visual fields. So there are difficulties. We don't have treatment for pale discs or optic neuropathy which are advanced. But at the same time, somebody who likes to be challenged intellectually, this is a branch to be in. And finance.
Thank you, Dr. Gandhi, for bringing up this issue. I think neuro-ophthalmology is a very mathematical branch, and you really get a diagnostic satisfaction. There is no doubt about it. And as neuro-ophthalmologists are much less, so you get really good referral, and so it's a good branch to choose for those who really have got a mathematical bend of mind and can really analyze the things well.
Can I make one more point about the surgical lack of surgery? What the one compromise which has been suggested is that maybe you can combine your ophthalmology with the orbital surgery or pediatric ophthalmology. In that way, you can diagnose your paralytic squints and operate on them.
Thank you.
Yes, that is one thing very important, because absolutely neuro-ophthalmology does not have surgery in it. It doesn't involve the surgery. So you have to be a general ophthalmologist for your bread and butter. And then you can have as a subject of special interest in your ophthalmology. Because as a professor in the medical college, you know, I've been always telling my residents, if you don't do cataract or glaucoma, what are you going to do? So what are you going to do?